potential of UK forestry hasn't yet been fully understood.
We need to be planting more areas to maintain the same level of production going forward.
Forestry actually absorbs CO2 and is the UK's natural carbon sink.
This is a unique supply chain. 100% of the tree can be turned into a product.
The productive side provides the money from the timber sales to allow us to invest in the biodiversity.
The whole topic of wood supply and wood security is absolutely paramount.
Out of the forest comes wood. It has many applications, so many, there's the potential to take wood for granted. From the sawmill, via timber frame and engineering companies, it makes it to construction. Every day we see it, often without making the link, in paper and packaging. Every book we read comes from the tree.
Yes, wood is certainly all around us in every shape and size wherever we live. But I, for one, really don't know as much about the forest and its achievements as I maybe should. So when people from the sector invited me to come and hear their case for wood, I said yes.
Kielder is the largest forest of its kind in Europe. But the issues I address here apply to all the nation's forests. I'll study every element in what is a key part of England's industrial landscape. I'll learn why capital investment requires continuity of supply from the forest. How the parts of a harvested tree find so many different uses. How wood leads the way in carbon capture. I'll hear how the forest has become more biodiverse. And visit communities where people value the support which the sector brings them.
One of the instantly surprising things about the Kielder Forest here is just what a large number of companies actually depend on it. It's a huge industry, isn't it?
Yes, it's the tree that brings all the industries together. We all use the different parts of the tree in different ways, but you know we are all reliant on that national treasure of the forest estate.
I want to find out how substantial a contributor the forest products sector is, especially to rural areas of England. This is an industry with a strong foothold across the country. In many forest areas, there's also a well-established and highly interdependent wood supply chain. Recent figures show that more than £7 billion goes into the UK economy every year from the sector. Forest industries directly employ nearly 170,000 people. The Egger chipboard plant at Hexham is only a few miles away from the forest. £400 million has been invested here in the last 25 years. A complex process involving round wood from the forest, chips and sawdust from sawmills, ultimately takes chipboard and laminated panels off to the furniture and construction industries. But there's nothing complex about why they've invested here.
The site here has benefited over the last 3 or 4 years with a major investment based on confidence that the wood supply would be here in the future. I think we've had the benefit over the last 25 years since we've been here in Hexham, that we've had a strong relationship, particularly with the Forestry Commission, with some very good contractual agreements with the Forestry Commission. And certainly we would have a level of uncertainty if that was to change in the future, and would certainly make those investment decisions a lot more difficult to make.
An industry which contributes then in economic, environmental and social terms. Yet the chairman at BSW Timber tells me its overall importance is not properly grasped.
Forestry has not been understood, and in fact the forest products manufacturing sector has been seen as an industry that exploits the asset of forestry. That is not true. The carbon credentials that forestry can bring forward to support the government's targets on a low carbon economy are really quite substantial. This carbon storage comes from within the trees as they grow. And I think most importantly, when those trees are harvested and manufactured into timber products, then the long-term storage of that carbon is a major contribution to the low carbon economy.
The structure of the forest is changing. Last century, many people believed it would remain forever as ranks of spruce working against biodiversity.
It is a completely different look to walk through a woodland like this. You can hear more birds. There isn't that deathly stillness that you sometimes are struck by.
Yeah, it is. And these younger forests that we see that were perhaps planted 40 years ago, with much more focus on a single species, have the opportunity to be diversified through restructuring over a period of time to be much more diverse, still capable of producing very good utilizable timber, but we have the added advantage of a much broader range of species and the wildlife, flora, fauna that goes with that. We need a focus on the productive side because that provides the money from the timber sales to allow us to invest in the biodiversity, in the recreation.
You've even got red squirrels around here.
We do indeed. We're very fortunate in the north of England here. We have, I think, two out of every three red squirrels that lives in the country is based up here in the north of England, so we're very fortunate.
I sense that the people harvesting timber here also go by strict economics. If trees are there to be felled in the future, yes, they'll invest. This is a small operation here, yet the two machines between them cost £500,000.
Well, over the last 10 years, technology's moved on so fast, and hence the price of the machines has moved on. We find that we can't invest this amount of money unless we have a continuity of work. We have guaranteed work of 5 years at a time, which makes us be able to invest. If we don't do that, we won't be able to survive in this industry.
Large-scale investors like James Jones and Sons, one of many families who've been in the business for generations, also need to know what lies ahead.
What has to be recognised is that investments like £25 million during the latest economic crisis, made by family companies who've been operating within the sector for many generations and allied to the contributions that they make towards the low carbon economy, would not be made without the security of supply.
The next stage in my journey along the wood supply chain is to Newcastle and a successful family business which favours home manufactured timber products. I want to hear their views on who will own the country's forests in the future.
I would be fundamentally against a radical change. We'll end up with disparate owners, with non-common goals, with potentially less certification, and I think that would be very bad for the UK timber industry. In the last 10 years, the business switched their use of structural timber to around about 90% being homegrown, a significant investment by wood milling industry has meant that we now have a product which is fit for purpose and one that we're very, very happy to sell on to our customers.
And from the architecture profession also, a wish to draw a line under changes in forest management.
UK forestry and timber products are poised to play a big role in decarbonising the built environment. So I think it would be a shame for us to diverge from that path now and fragment our forestry ownership and governance just at a time when the industry wants to exploit it as creatively as they can.
More access to the forest helps sport and leisure flourish. A more biodiverse forest is better for both people and wildlife. That's mainly achieved through money coming back to the Forestry Commission and woodland owners from timber sales. In a very wet West Cumberland, they like their rugby league. The youth setup here is sponsored by Iggesund Paperboard. Roger Blair's been part of the team at the plant for over 30 years.
I think the community appreciate the fact that Iggesund's here and they're employing so many people in the area, that much money going back into the local economy. In return, Iggesund see it as their obligation to put money back into the community, and this is a form of sponsorship that we like doing.
Well, I can tell you my visit to the north has shown me the position industry commands in this forest area. And I've certainly got a keener understanding of how companies here depend on each other and, crucially, why they want to see the forest continuing to grow. It would be a strange world, I suppose, if the forests and everything they go on to create were to be put at risk.